But it's Allah who does that. And this is also a rejection of the superstition that existed at that time. The Greeks believed that thunder was about the anger of God, which is, I mean, that's superstitious. This is that it's a sign of God, and what it does is, on the one hand, it shows you this power, but on the other hand, it's fear and hope. That's our relationship with Allah, is one of awe of His power, but also of hope, because we believe that ultimately that Allah is benevolent, that Allah is not antagonistic to our needs. He's in fact the facilitator of our needs. That is our ultimate relationship with Allah. But He's also has these attributes that are awe-inspiring and should cause concern. وَيُنَزِّلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. And this is what this whole thing is about. He brings from the heaven water, in other words, this dunya heaven of this world, because there are many meanings of heaven in the Quran. فَيُحْيِ بِهِ الْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. And then He brings back the earth to life after it was dead. إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَعْقِلُونَ. And in this is a sign for people who use their intellect. And then, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَن تَقُومَ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضُ بِأَمْرِهِ. And from His signs is that the heavens and the earth are maintained because of His command. That the whole maintenance of this thing is because Allah has commanded it. And Allah says, أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِي بِرَبِّكَ أَنُّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. Isn't it enough for you that Allah is witnessing this whole thing as a sign? That is very interesting, because Niels Bohr, the quantum physicist, said that nothing exists except if it's observed. I mean, that was his conclusion about the universe, that it had to be observed in order for it to really exist. And that is one of the signs that Allah says, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. We're going to continue to show them our signs in themselves and on the horizon, حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنُّهُ الْحَقِّ, until it becomes clear that this is the truth. أَوَرَمْ يَكْفِي بِرَبِّكَ أَنُّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. Isn't it enough that He's witnessing the whole thing as a proof? Because the only way it could exist is by His mushahada. If you remove Allah's عَيْنُ الْعِنَايَةِ, the eye of providence, from existence, existence no longer exists. And so from amongst His signs is that this whole thing is maintained because of this amr of Allah. ثُمَّ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ دَعْوَةً مِنَ الْأَرْضِ إِذَا أَنْتُمْ تَخْرُجُونَ. That إِذَا أَنْتُمْ تَخْرُجُونَ. Then if He calls you a calling from the earth, suddenly you're coming forth. So this is all about reviving. Now, how this relates, and I'll just talk briefly about this, how this relates to marriage. Marriage is one of the most important and foundational institutions in the world, and it's never been threatened in the way it's being threatened now. Every culture has an understanding of the sanctity of marriage. In primitive cultures, there are all of these taboos around relationships between individuals. And in more sophisticated cultures, the institution of marriage often enters into legal aspects, because it deals with property and it deals with elements that are related to living in the city and living in a more complex type of culture. So in Islam, at the root of the Sharia are laws related to marriage. And that is why, if you look in a book of fiqh, the most extensive chapter in books of fiqh are marriage and divorce. The rules related to marriage and divorce are more diverse, and there are more elements involved in that than any other single section of the Sharia. And that is because that really is at the center of this whole matter. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, one of the things that he brought was a new arrangement, a new configuration involving male and female relations. And much of the past was in fact abrogated. In traditional Christianity, for instance, divorce was prohibited completely. And when the Prophet ﷺ introduced the idea in Islam of divorce, which is an abrogation of that prohibition, even though Reformed Christianity has allowed divorce. But in traditional Catholicism and in the first Christianity, you could not divorce your wife. It was a wife or a husband for life. And so the Prophet ﷺ came with new aspects. Another one was property division. I mean, that was another aspect. And inheritance laws. And the fact that traditionally prior to that, in many cultures, women were inherited with property. These type of things. So in looking at this relationship, one of the things that I really see in the verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned is that there's a very profound and deep cosmology in this human relationship. And if we see the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that, I think it changes the experience of the relationship, because not only are there signs in the male and the female, but also in children and in living together and in this constant recreation that's going on, the experience of being with another person in the world and growing with them, things dying in the past, things being reborn in the present, and then that process happening again and again. If we look at, you know, the foundation of the Prophet ﷺ's teaching, it's really in honoring and cherishing not only the institution, but what's at the root of it, which is the protection of women and children. Because that really is at the root of marriage in Islam. And that is why the Sharia, I think if we look, and inshallah we will, at these rights and responsibilities, and then in how we can nurture our children in that, I think what you'll find is that the vast majority of the responsibility is on the male to honor the female. And I think that much of what's happened in the Muslim world, and I really believe this personally, much of what's happened in the Muslim world and the traumas that exist in the Muslim world relate to what's happening in the houses. I really believe that. And I feel that there's an immense amount of work that needs to be done in changing these basic relationships and in really honoring the sacred trust, because this is one of the things in the final Hajj address, the Prophet ﷺ warned us about this trust. He said that you have been entrusted with your women, and he said, don't oppress them. And that was his final message. And one of the last things he said on his deathbed was, take care of your women. Because in order to humanize the world, our women have to be protected. They have to be in a space that that process can happen. And if the space is not there, the security, the aman. And I think the loss of security in the world is only a reflection of the loss of security in the house. I think that a lot of what we're seeing outside is really a reflection of what's happening inside. Because in this country, if you look at so much of the troubled elements of modern society, I think you often find that it's rooted in very troubled homes. So I think there's an immense amount of work to do on ourselves, because I think about this a lot just with my own children, is just the fragility of their nature. Just looking at them with a mean glance can completely devastate them. And the thing is that we become hardened to those things. And that's one of the reasons why the Prophet ﷺ, he said, حُبِّبَ إِلَيَّ مِن دُنْيَاكُمْ ثَلَاثٌ, I was made to love three things from the world. And one of them was an-nisa, which is women. And people should in no way think that that was any reference to sexual aspect, because it's just not. He said an-nisa, which is women. You know, Anjasha is one of my favorite hadiths. He was a young man who had a beautiful voice, and he used to sing for the camels. He was a cameleer, what they call hadi. And he was singing one night. They were in a caravan, and he was singing one night, and the women were in a tent nearby. And Anjasha's voice was so beautiful, the Prophet said, Rifqan wayhaka ya Anjasha, qurub an-nas qawarir. And then in another one, he said, Rifqan bir qawarir. Go easy on these easily broken vessels. Because that's also part of the nature of the woman, is that her heart is more brittle. And that's something that the Prophet loved about women, was that that it's easier for them, because Allah is with the brokenhearted in the hadith. In Allah 'inda mukassirati qulubuhum. Allah is with the brokenhearted. One of the reasons that we're here is to get our hearts broken, because until they're broken, there's no room, you know, until they're emptied of all the stuff of this world. And that's part of the breaking. It's all to empty you of this madness. So I wanted to start that though with the Quran, because I just feel like we really need to start looking more as a community at the Quran and reconnecting with the Quran, because it's just either we're focused on very specific verses in which we justify our worldview, which is very easy to do with the Quran. You can kind of find everything. Everybody can find what they're looking for. The Quran says, "Alima kullu unasin masharabuhum." Everybody knows what hole they're, the watering hole they want to drink from. And the Quran will offer you that. But inshallah, if we take it in its totality, which means studying it holistically and trying to understand it as it explains itself to us, inshallah.